it's Jasmine. So today I am going to talk about products that aren't hyped up about anymore. And I know for some people you guys may still be using these products, but in general, as a whole, we don't hear people talking about it. So I have my big bag full of makeup products to talk about. So let's dive in and grab our first item, which is the Morphe 35L. Remember, 2015-2016 era. That in itself was all dedicated towards the 35L. If you forgot her, this is what she looked like. I think everybody was drawn to this palette because of these two rows. Because it was like the first palette that had these bright orange shades. They are very good in blendability. You get a lot of shades for not a lot of money. You know, 35 shades for about $20. That's a pretty good deal. As eyeshadow palettes evolved and as they started to expand into every single brand, I feel like this one soon got neglected because there are other brands who we may have preferences for over Morphe. So that can be the case. And I feel like in my circumstance, I feel like Morphe for me isn't my ideal eyeshadow quality taste. So that's the real reason why I just don't pick it up. But I do still keep the palette because I do use this on my clients. And I feel like it's just a good palette overall just to have. But in general, who really does use their 35L anymore? So this palette that I'm going to mention next is dated really far back. So if you guys used to watch Michelle Phan, you guys remember how in one of her videos she used this exact palette, and I thought to myself, you know, one day I'm gonna get that palette and I'm gonna be just like Michelle. I am gonna be Michelle. So I actually ended up getting it. It was actually sent to me, which was actually so nice. This is the Sigma Warm Neutrals palette. When this initially launched, everybody was going crazy. This was like the only neutral eyeshadow palette that had a little bit of everything. Now I feel like it did fall off because Sigma isn't really known for their makeup as much as their brushes. They're starting to get into makeup, but I feel like makeup and cosmetic wise, I feel like that is not their strong point. They definitely need to improve on their formula, their quality, all that stuff. But you know, for this coming out in like 2013, I felt like really shook everybody. And I mean, it's a good palette. Again, I use this mostly on brides. So it's a really neutral palette. Is it warm? No, it's not. It's not a warm palette. It's not a warm neutral. It's just a neutral palette, ma'am. So I'm excited to see what else Sigma has in store as far as eyeshadows are concerned. You know what? If I were to work for Sigma, granted I am an affiliate, but if I were to actually work in their factory and be like a creative director, oh, I would take the brand so far. Now this palette started a whole entire trend. This palette started the whole contour kit trend. The original Anastasia contour kit. Now I actually mixed two different contour kits together. I have the tan to deep and then I also have the light to medium, half and half here. So I just put it all in here because these products that I'm sharing with you are ones that I have in my client kit. So I'm constantly using them on people because I don't use them on myself. And I feel like these type of palettes like contour kits, big eyeshadow palettes, I feel like are ideal for somebody who is a freelance makeup artist. So when you're on the go and you kind of need like, you know, just one shade, I don't think that taking a whole bronzer palette will be ideal if you're just going to be using one shade for yourself. Does that make any sense? I hope it makes sense. But yeah, I don't feel like anybody talks about this, and the only people who do use it now, I feel like, are freelance makeup artists. And even yet, there are other brands who have a lot of contour kits as well. So we're not, some people aren't even just exclusively using this, people are using other brands. So like I said before with the Morphe shadows, it's kind of like, what is your preference and is it budget friendly? Is, you know, all those other factors that you can and should consider. I think for about a year and a half straight, everybody was talking about this product, and I waited until last year to finally buy it. And to my surprise, but not really my surprise, I put myself in this situation. It's not my shade, so it doesn't look good on me, but it looks good on other people, so I keep it in my client kit. The Jeffree Star Peach Goddess Skin Frost. I felt like everybody and their mom was talking about this color in particular. This was from his original launch of his Skin Frost. Everybody said it's so blinding, it's so yummy on the skin, and I just felt like on me it looked ashy because I have a strong yellow undertone. So anything peach, anything pink on my skin as a highlight is going to look ashy. So with that being said, although I do like it, it's something that I reserve for other people. Now his highlights kind of died down because now I feel like his brand is more focused on eyeshadow palettes, which is really nice. And plus he just launched those Supreme Frost highlights, I think that's what they're called. So the actual original Velour highlights have gotten a little bit more dulled down with popularity, but I know some people still use them day to day, but as like the vast majority of the people who I watch on YouTube, my friends, anybody who has his highlights, I feel like they don't really use it as much anymore. The next product that I want to share with you guys, I feel like still is hyped up. I'm not sure if people are still buying it, but I know a lot of people still reference it, so it's still relevant, and that's kind of why I want to mention it too. The Urban Decay Electric Palette. When other brands come out with colored eyeshadow palettes, and if you are a makeup collector, enthusiast, you probably have this palette, and you probably always reference it whenever you buy a colored eyeshadow palette, because you think to yourself, do I already have that shade? And I guarantee you that the Electric Palette is probably going to be like your most used. And I don't know, I feel like it's not my most used, I don't want to say that, but it's definitely one that I go for whenever I need a bold color. Low-key, Laura Lee Los Angeles, her brand, she low-key copied this with one of her palettes, so, So, the next one is the RCMA No Color Powder. I felt like for a long time, everybody loved this because it was such a good universal powder. The hype died down because of the packaging. Everybody who reviewed this, everybody who talked about it said, I love this powder, but I wish it was in a different packaging. Kind of got people a little turned off to using it and to kind of stop mentioning it in their videos because it's inconvenient. As for me, like I said, I use this for my clients because it's easier for me to pour out, but if you're using it on yourself, I could see why that's such a big deal because you're not worrying about sanitation when you're just using it on yourself. But is this a good powder? Yes, and I do like it. They do need to upgrade their packaging, especially for those who are not working makeup artists and who are actually looking to use this on themselves. Gerard had a hot moment. You remember that? She had a really hot moment. Everybody was obsessed. And I thought to myself, you know, one day I'm gonna get a Gerard Cosmetics product. Here I am when nobody talks about Gerard. People probably forgot. People who are starting to get into makeup probably are like, who's Gerard? They're like, who's that? But remember when Slay All Day Spray, or even their lipsticks, their light up LED lipstick? Remember that? I felt like everybody loved it, but I feel like maybe the reason why nobody talks about it is because she's not coming out with anything new or innovative. When I went on their website not too long ago, I still saw the same things that I saw a few years back. So in my head, I'm thinking, do they think they're just like a one-hit wonder type of deal? Or are they thinking of actually expanding the brand? Because I would kind of be excited for that. Even though their stuff is a little expensive, for this little bottle, it's like 20 bucks. Give them a try because their products are good as far as me trying just this spray. It's pretty good as far as being trendy. I don't think they're there yet and they're not catching the attention of consumers. This foundation is worth the hype, okay? It's worth every single hype. Now, it did die down, but I think that if you have this, you use it kind of sparingly. You don't use, this is not an everyday foundation, let me tell you that. It's not an everyday foundation. This is the foundation reserved for the days where you need your foundation to last all day, where you need it to literally look the same from the time you apply it to the time you take it off. This is the type of foundation that you wear to amusement parks, on dates, maybe to prom. And I feel like people really hyped it up because Alyssa Ashley actually helped create the color range in the foundation range. And this, I think, had, 45 colors. So something super, super good. And again, NYX is really affordable, but nobody talks about it because I feel like it is such a matte foundation. And it's kind of for the people who don't really have dry skin. And I feel like a lot of people, especially when this launched, was really into dewy, fresh, glowy skin, and I felt like this was kind of the exact opposite, but nonetheless, I think it's really, really good and that you should try it. I do have a whole review on it, so if you're interested in that, I'll have it linked somewhere on the top. This is not the shade that I want to talk about. I wanted to talk about, what is it, Milkshake? Is it Milkshake? It's not Milkshake. Milkshake. What color am I thinking of? I don't know. I don't have my phone here. I don't want to get it. It's charging. But when Anastasia released her liquid lipsticks for the first time, she had a light shade in her line that was a nude. And I felt like everybody really, really hyped it up. And everybody said, like, this is like the perfect nude, all that stuff. And then she released more nudes and everybody hyped that up as well. They said, oh, finally, she launched more colors in her nude selection. But after that, and after everybody got their PR lists, you don't see Anastasia liquid lipsticks anymore. You don't see Anastasia lip products anymore. And I don't know what the deal is with that, because I think her lip products are great, okay? I think that they are absolutely amazing, and they're slept on low-key. Like, these actually stay on the lips. And although they are not, like, 100% budge-proof, they stay on the lips pretty well. And I can guarantee you, you can get through a meal with this on, okay? So, with that being said, I still think that these are worth the hype, but I feel like they just kind of got lost. I wanted to mention this particular product because I was watching Kathleen Light's video this morning where she was doing her declutter of primers and concealers, and then she mentioned this, the No Pore Blown Primer. And as most of you guys know, this is my holy grail primer, but like she said in her video, it was kind of like she was trying other primers, she liked other primers, and then this kind of just got forgotten. When people use it, they say, oh my god, it's like the best primer, and then they go ahead and try something else and then they forget it. So if you're watching this and you have it, bring it back out, use it, and then go buy another primer when you finish using it, okay? I'm tired of seeing people hoard, I'm talking to myself, products, and they just don't use it up completely, and they continuously buy things that they don't need. Jasmine, use up your Touch and Soul No Pore Blown primers. They're really, really good, and they're really inexpensive. It's $18 for this, and okay, I know for some people that's not inexpensive, but considering the actual formula, the finish of it on the skin, everything like that, all the factors of this, it's inexpensive for what it's giving you. Finally, for the last item, I wanted to talk about a ColourPop product because I feel like I kind of talked about things that were in the double digit range. So let's bring in something that's a single digit. So this one is the ColourPop Supernova Shadow. And I felt like when these launched, everybody was comparing these to the Stila Liquid Eyeshadow. That's what they're called, Liquid Eyeshadow. The Stila ones are so strong in hype. I have never tried it. I feel like they're so strong in hype that people just prefer those over these. And if you apply a glitter on top or even a really nice metallic eyeshadow on top, you get a pretty good effect. I don't know how similar it is to the Stila liquid shadow, but I can guarantee you that it looks really stunning, and it looks extremely foiled, and it looks extremely multi-dimensional on the eyes. People just forget these, and I don't know if it's the fact that it's a liquid, because I know not a lot of people go for liquids, but I just think that these should get a little bit more recognition now. It's starting to get into holiday season. These are good stocking stuffers, just pop them in or even just give them out as regular gifts. Like, they're really, really good, and I feel like the hype shouldn't have died down on these, honestly. So I hope you guys all enjoyed my small accumulation of products that I felt like through visualization fell off the charts as far as being really, really hyped up. So I hope my little inputs kind of gave you guys like a little light bulb effect to maybe try them out again if you have them hidden in your collection. Just bring it out again. Do you still like it? Do you not like it? Was it worth the hype at all? Anything like that. I hope this video concept was a little bit different for you guys, because I've been really trying to be a little bit more creative as far as my content goes. So I hope you guys all enjoy, and I will see you guys in my next one. Bye! Peace out, Girl Scouts.